tonight's meeting is to examine the budget for fiscal year 2012-2013. However, it is not the only item on the agenda, and if we can take a minute, fellow commissioners, and review the agenda, I'd like to consider the order of the agenda, including the consent agenda. And I do want to make just a couple of comments about the agenda tonight. We've had a lot of discussion and feedback from citizens concerning the proposed change in the parks and recreation fees and fee schedule. We are not going to address those fee increases and changes tonight. That item and that subject has been tabled. If you are here and want information about that, or you would like to speak to anyone about that, there will be a meeting scheduled with our Parks and Rec Director, Mr. Brian Haygood, who is, where are you, Brian? This side. Over here, you're right. If you would let him know of your concern either tonight or call him in the morning, and I don't think the meeting has been scheduled, but his plan is to get with the Parks and Rec Committee to meet with the different clubs in the county to discuss the fee schedule. Again, that item will be removed from any consideration of the budget. The incremental effect of the revenue from that change would not take place until probably the beginning of September anyway, so we have time to revisit that and do an amendment later if necessary. So that item will not be part of the budget discussion. Commissioners, are there any changes or additions to the agenda, including the consent agenda? Hearing none, we'll accept a motion for approval.
So moved.
Thank you, Eddie. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Bill. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The agenda, including the consent agenda, have been approved. Next on the agenda is the public comments. Now, let me speak about this for a minute. We, at all of our meetings, have a public comment section where our citizens can speak, provide us input on any subject that you would like, and that is certainly the case this evening. If you are here to discuss and talk about the budget, that will not be part of this. We will have a separate public hearing shortly where you can speak about input on the Alamance County budget. However, if you are here to speak about anything else and have not signed the sign-up sheet that Ms. Hooks has, please do so now, and then she'll bring it up to the front. Again, this is our public comment section where you can speak about anything you want to. We do, for the public comment section, have a 3-minute time limit. So again, if you have not signed up for public comments and you wish to speak about anything other than the budget, please do so now. Seeing none, hearing none, Sherry, if you want to bring that on up, we'll move into the public comment section of our meeting. Thank you. And we only have one, Mr. Christopher Tate. If you'd like to come forward, we welcome you. Christopher is here tonight to talk about a special project he's involved in. He visited with us last year. Good evening, sir.
Good evening. On behalf of the Alamance Amateur Radio Club and all amateur radio operators across the state of North Carolina, we invite you to Field Day. Field Day is an emergency preparedness exercise for amateur radio operators. Ham radio operators work with local agencies, for example, the fire department, the police department, the National Weather Service, and others. One of the events that we do as part of Field Day is we handle traffic messages. If you attend Field Day, we will also allow you to send a message to a counterpart in a sister city or community, a friend, or even Governor Bev Perdue, the White House, or our representative in Congress. This is also excellent practice for ham radio operators. Besides the emergency preparedness exercise, Field Day is an amateur radio contest, and the objective of which is to score the most points and gain fame. And last but not least, it is a ton of fun. I can attest that it is much, much, much fun. This year's Field Day will be June 23rd and 24th. I believe that is the last weekend in June. The event starts at 2 p.m. on Saturday, runs all night, yes, all night, until 2 p.m. on Sunday afternoon. It will be held at the Burlington Police Club at 721 Birch Bridge Road, about a half mile from the WBAG AM radio station. I hope to see you there.
Thank you, Chris.
Chris, thank you for coming.
Thank you, Chris.
And Randy, thank you for bringing him.
Yeah.
Chris, if you want to stay around and help us solve this budget mess, you're welcome to do so. It sounds like you've got a good handle on things. That's the only public comment we have. And at this time, we will go to the next item on the agenda, which include any commissioner responses at this time. Hearing none, we will go to item number 6, which is one of two public hearings we have tonight. I'd like to call on Jason Martin. Jason is going to be discussing a public hearing for the Rural Operating Assistance Program, also known as the ROPE funds for Alamance County. Jason, welcome.
Chairman, Commissioners, good evening. You should have in your packet a memorandum from me with regards to the Rural Operating Assistance Program, or ROPE, public hearing for tonight. This is a grant that the county receives every year for elderly and disabled transportation, work first and employment transportation, and then rural general public. This year there is the allocation amounts are $100,682 for EdTAP, $59,878 for the employment work first funding, and rural general public $141,519. In your packet, you should also have the sub-allocation worksheet, which this year, in years past, the funding has been split between the Department of Social Services, Alamance County Transportation Authority, and the Alamance County Community Services Agency. This year, all funding is allocated to ACTA. And the reason for that is there were program changes in the ROPE funding this year for employment work first. That is geared strictly towards trips for to take people to work or to take them to job training, to school, that sort of thing, as opposed to car repairs and gas vouchers, which the other agencies had been doing in the past. It's not allowed anymore. So all funding has been allocated to them. And then from there, you should have another sub-allocation worksheet for the EdTAP portion, which are the agencies that ACTA coordinates with to take elderly and disabled folks to doctor's appointments, dialysis. Primary use of the funds is for dialysis patients. That being said, I will be glad to take any questions from the board at this time.
This is the information prior to going into the public hearing, is that correct?
That is correct.
Can you summarize for folks that may not have this, the difference in the dollar amounts for 2012, 2013 compared to what actually will be received by the time 2012 is over?
Okay, yeah, last year, well under the, I have the EdTAP information specific for that. Last year, Alamance County received $104,682 and this year, the county is set to receive $100,682. There was a small deduction in the amount for EdTAP funding. There was an increase, though, in rural general public funding. And this, the allocations, the sub-allocations from ACTA are adjusted based on the percentages that they had divvied out in the previous year. It's the same percentages, just adjusted for the total amount that's being received.
Are there questions for Jason before we entertain a motion for the public hearing? The public hearing is required to process and accept these funds. Is there a motion that we now go into the beginning of a public hearing for this purpose?
So moved.
Thank you, Bill, Linda. Mm-hmm. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Do we have anyone with us tonight that would like to speak on the subject of the Rural Operating Assistance Program, also known as the ROPE funds, that are administered through our ACTA, Alamance County Transit Authority group? Is there anyone that would like to speak on this subject? Hearing none. Jason, do you have any remarks?
Yes, sir.
And I don't think Mr. Williams is here tonight with ACTA.
He's probably in Burlington. They were doing a...
Oh, that's right. He's at the council. That's right. That's right. Hearing none, is there a motion that we close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. Bill and Eddie, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
You oppose? Now, let's hope the other public hearing goes as smoothly. Thank you, Jason. Okay. Next item is the public hearing on the fiscal year 2012-2013 budget. What we'll do at this time is invite individuals who would like to speak on the subject matter of the budget. The only comment I'd like to make about that is that we want everybody to speak and have a turn. This is a public hearing. It's not a public debate. Once we have heard your input, we appreciate that, and we thank you for letting others then to have their turn and allowing them the time and also the lack of interruption or disturbance or noise to hear everybody. And that's really what we'd like to do tonight. Once the public hearing is over, then we'll turn it over to our county manager, who will basically bring everybody up to speed on where we are to date, and then have further discussion from the commissioners at that time. With that as background, would like to entertain a motion to open the public hearing for the budget ordinance for fiscal year 2012-2013.
So moved.
Thank you, Linda, Bill, Tori, vice versa, it's up to you.
Yeah.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. The first guess, if you will, that we'd like to hear at the commissioner's request from the last meeting are representatives from three of our volunteer fire districts. Two of the fire districts have requested an increase in their tax rate, and the third one received an increase last year, and the commissioners have requested an update on the use of those funds at that time. So the three that I have, we'll just take the two that are requesting increases in alphabetical order, and the first one that would be the Elon Fire District. So would there be a representative that would like to come forward and speak on behalf of the Elon Fire Department? Welcome, sir.
Good evening. My name is Steve Floyd. I'm president of the board of directors of Elon Fire Rescue. We have come before the county commissioners for requested 0.5% increase in our fire tax rate. It's been 10 years since we have asked for any type of request from the county for an increase. Just for, I've given you all, had a packet that was delivered to you several weeks ago, explained where our expenditures and our revenues come from. It's pretty clear it's been like that through the years. I guess one thing I would point out to you, the annexations from Burlington have been an impact to our department over the past 10 years. We've lost approximately $75,000 in revenue each year. That's built to this year. Just this year, we've lost $40,000. We have been spending some of our reserves to continue to improve our department and the services that we provide. In 2000, we had over $669,000 in savings. And this year, right now, we have about $266,000 in savings. So we have been using some of our reserves to make some improvements to equipment, supplies, services. Basically, we feel that's a justifiable request, and we hope you'd see so. If you have any questions, we'll try and answer them for you.
Thank you, Steve.
Can I ask a question, please?
Sure.
What is your rating? I forgot the technical term, but it's the rating for your service versus...
ISO rating?
Yes, sir.
We're rated as a 5 and a 4. Excuse me. 4 inside, 5 outside.
The town limit?
Correct. At the EC Fire District, it's a 5.
Other questions for Steve at this time? We certainly can, if you'll stick around, be in a position to perhaps ask you questions a little bit later as well.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Next representative from the Fawcett Fire District, are folks with us tonight? Does that mean no?
I guess not.
And folks from the E.M. Holt Fire District. Guys, welcome.
I agree with you.
Good evening, sir.
I was asked to come here on May the 23rd. Mr. Henry Vines sit up here and asked to take my cent and three quarter back. Had Mr. Henry Vines stopped by our station and asked to see a copy of our budget, he'd realize that we had to cut $27,000 out of our budget this year. And he spoke of our air packs. Our air packs cost us $192,000. We have an annual payment of $40,000 a year for 5 years. Also, our budget increase last year was not only on air packs, it was the insurance, like workers' comp, which went from $3,400 to $6,700 this year. It was also for paid physicals. I make all our firefighters, volunteer and all, have physicals, which was $6,500. We also had to replace three AEDs that were outdated, which was $7,200. Also, VFIS made me install a fire alarm system in Station 19, which was $6,500, $350 a year monitoring fee. But like I said, we cut $27,000 due to annexation. In your last meeting, you stated that we sold our old air packs. Our old air packs, we tried to donate them to a station down east that lost everything, and we can't even give them away. They only have 3 years left on the bottle. So we have tried to give them away. Nobody wants them. They're no good to anybody because of the OSHA standards. You're talking about annexation. We've been annexed five times since 2009. And a lot of our increase was due to annexation. That's one of the things I want to bring up. We had a barn fire 2 weeks ago. This is what it cost at the 40 by 40 barn. Cost us almost $1,000. The fire started at 11:30. We was through at 5. Between fuel, foam, water, for the guys and everything, it cost me about $1,000. That's just for one small fire. I was looking, and I checked Mr. Henry Vines. He pays only $164 a year in fire tax. He has two chicken houses that are 50 by 300. So it would be three times that much. So there's a lot of costs that people don't realize in firefighting. Like I said, we have been annexed three times, and that's what's put us in a bind now.
What does annexing have to do with the cost?
Annexation, each time we get annexed, that we lose money. They only have to pay us half. They only have to pay us half of what our true tax value is.
Okay.
So we've lost almost $200,000 since 2009.
Did you lose some of the airport?
We lost the airport. We lost all of our industry this year. So that's what's the reason we had to go for a cent and three quarter last year. A lot of it was due to annexation and to pay for stuff.
Basically, what you're doing is losing industry in the area.
Yeah, we lost. We lost
your tax.
Higher tax base there, yeah.
So that's what we, like I said, I think it was a misunderstanding and misinformed on what we owe, and that we sold air packs and got revenue off of it. We didn't get any revenue, and like I said, we couldn't even give them away. That was one thing. A lot of people don't think about volunteers. if we had a disaster tonight, what would we do tomorrow without volunteers? So we need to take care of our volunteers and make sure we keep them, because we lose them every day. It's getting harder and harder to get volunteers. So that's one thing that I hope this county thinks about.
How many full-time staff do you have?
I've got 3 full-time, I've got 8 part-time, and we got 50 volunteers. So we've been pretty fortunate when it comes to volunteers.
What are your ratings out there?
ISO
rating. ISO rating 7.
A 7?
7, yeah. And we're working towards redoing our rating. What hurt us last time is our industry. I know when I told y'all last year, we didn't have enough equipment to meet our fire flow due to the industry we have. So hopefully this time we're looking to go to a 5. That's what we hope to get to.
So it works in reverse. The lower the number,
the better the insurance. Right. The better it helps the homeowner.
Yeah, we had a speaker that we asked to come in from the state, I believe, to explain all this.
Yeah. He's a Mevin.
Yeah, Mevin.
Chief Bradley.
Yeah. It was pretty interesting.
Mark, I called you and we talked the other day, and I think you've answered all the questions I had. I appreciate you coming tonight to explain where you are on this.
All right. Thank you.
We do appreciate it.
Thanks, Chief. Craig, what is the increase that Fawcett was requesting?
Half a cent.
What is there right now?
Let's see, I'm sorry. Right now it is 8.75, and they've requested go to 9.25.
9.25. What's their fund balance?
Not sure.
Amy, do you know? Where's the fire marshal at?
Dave.
Do you know?
Their fund balance.
Sir?
I do not know their fund balance.
Do you know their rating?
Yes, sir. They are at 6.
They're a 6. I'd like to ask the Elon chief, you had a public meeting for your request, right?
Yes, sir.
Sir?
Yes.
How many people showed up for that?
Nobody.
Nobody? And they were properly notified?
Absolutely.
How are they notified?
Newspaper.
And that's required for all fire departments after the policy we put in about a year ago. And I really do appreciate the fire departments working with us on that. And they really have complied to follow through with that request.
And I think one thing with Steve and Elon there, you have a lot more properties that are not tax-based over there that you're dealing with. Is that correct? I mean, as Elon grows, you're covering a lot of area that's not really paying in, which is now, has Elon, have you talked with Elon about up in there?
We're talking about the university.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
I mean, as they expand, which they are everywhere, seem to be a thing to do. Yeah.
You certainly have a lot of responsibility in there.
We do.
Sure.
I was an insurance agent by trade. I had to insure all these wonderful fire departments. Mark, I'm sorry they put that system in, but that would be if I had one. And I visit these departments on a regular basis. And I've been in every one of these stations, and I've seen their equipment, I've seen the dedication of their personnel. You know, Alamance County has a great deal. I think with what we get as residents of this county, services is a wonderful thing. They work hard to provide for their communities and their districts. They don't top by any means, but when they come to you with a request, I think they come to you with sincerity in what they're asking for, so they can continue to give the best service they possibly can to this county and their districts.
Thank you, Steve. Are there other questions or comments about the fire departments? Dave?
If I can, too, I'd like to also speak on behalf of Fawcett. First of all, I stand corrected. I checked their ISO rating is a 7, and they were rated last year, and they were deficient in a couple of areas on equipment, and they were wanting to purchase this equipment. As you know, we are in the process of trying to get a 6-mile insurance rating district for all of our areas throughout the county. And part of that will be they'll have to be re-inspected, all of our fire departments will. And at that time, it's Fawcett's hope to possibly up their rating to that 6. That's what they're shooting for with some of the equipment. And they, much like E.M. Holt, will be losing some of their territory to annexation from Burlington in the future too as well. So that, you know, as Steve mentioned, you know, they're trying to give the best they can, the best service. And they did go through the process in which every department has for any type of increase. They did go through that entire process too as well, with the public hearings, advertising, everything. So yeah. I apologize for them not being here tonight, but again, they are in the same situation as everybody else, trying to provide the best they can. They have had to hire some full-time staff for daytime use, just like other rural setting departments, where the volunteers are kind of drying up a little bit from that standpoint, so we have to put a full-time man there during the day.
Do you know if anybody showed up at their public hearing?
I can get that number for you. I'm not aware of how many showed up.
I wish they had showed up tonight to speak for themselves.
All of them have provided that information. When they submit their budgets, they provide documentation as to how they announced their public hearings and the times in which they held them too as well. So all that has been followed up each time they submit.
And all were requested to be here, and they were properly notified about this meeting tonight as well.
Does Elon, their city budget give you allocations? What percentage of your budget is Elon versus county?
It would be under a little less than half. You got to realize they pay for eight staff, pay for staff members, and they have equipment, they have trucks, and some loan payments also.
We can vote on the people here tonight, and can't we delay Fawcett until a second meeting in June and have them come before us?
As long as it's done before June 30th, yes, sir.
Yeah, that's what I'd prefer to do on Fawcett.
I agree with you on that, too.
So, is that a motion? If we are in a position later on to vote on the budget, we could do that, but with an amendment then to address the Fawcett
right.
Fire District.
We wouldn't have to have a separate public hearing because this was the quite public hearing.
All right, and Tim's suggestion, do you need that in the form of a motion?
You can either do it now or do it later, whatever you so choose.
You want to just wait and do it all?
Yeah, that's what I would like
hold it
to
out.
Do.
Okay.
All right. Okay, any other discussion about the fire districts, volunteer fire? Thank you all for being here for that portion. I'm going to do this real scientifically. If anyone would like to speak, we'll just start with this row in the front and invite anyone in the front row to come forward at this time, and please introduce yourself as you would like to speak. Jennifer, would you like to speak? Welcome. Don't apologize. That's why we're doing this.
That's right. So sorry. Appreciate you guys letting me speak tonight. I do have a little handout I'd like to give you, so that you can look at what I'm looking at.
All right. Very good.
Appreciate that. All of the numbers that I'm referencing are from the North Carolina Treasurer's State audited site, which is not on the website.
You identify yourself to the crowd.
Jennifer Talley, Living Graham.
Thank you.
At the beginning of have each budget, proposed budget for 06, 07, 08, 09, 2010, and the 2012. The manager has put in basically a nice little summary at the beginning. It's the same one that we got when I was on the city council for 6 years. Kind of gives you a summary of what you're looking at, kind of a, so, you know, you kind of have a little synopsis of what the main important things are. One of the things he talks about is that the tax basis has decreased. If you go back and look each year, though, that number has changed. And this is a really important piece of information, because when you look at the tax basis, everybody, every county commissioner, every person on the staff, in 2008, when that new tax figure came out for what that tax basis amount was, 12 point something billion dollars, is that right? We all knew that number wasn't correct. Budgets weren't formulated based on that number. So to try to use that number in every single budget year to say, yes, they've decreased for that number, we knew that number wasn't correct to begin with. We didn't formulate our budgets based on that number. And if you look at that number, when you go back to 2009, it's this huge number of, you know, several million dollars that we're falling short on. It wasn't money that we had to begin with. It was incorrect information. So to say that we haven't increased property revenues, that just isn't correct. If you look at the numbers, we have increased property revenues. And I ask you to look at the revenues that we have and that I have outlined for you consistently, 06, 07, 08, 09, 2010, 2011, and even for 2012 when I talked to their staff, revenues for property taxes have increased consistently and will continue to increase consistently. My argument here, of course, is to not increase property taxes. They have consistently brought in 97% collection rates. They do an excellent job. He has an excellent staff that collects tax revenues. But to basically say that we're losing in property tax revenues is really a play on words, you know, to try to make you justify raising property taxes. The tax basis in 07 was $10.4 billion. Then in 08, 09, it went to $10.9 billion. In 09, 10, it went to $12.5 billion. When the proposal speaks of a decrease, it's referring to the total number that everyone, including the county commissioners and the staff, knew were incorrect. I'm hoping the county commissioners will listen closely and look at the proposed numbers with an unbiased opinion, and believe you will see there are many other solutions to balancing our budget rather than just raising taxes. We've been taxed to death. Everything, including these fees, which we're not talking about tonight, some of those fees are 150% increases. You know, property taxes affect a select group of people and businesses that benefit no more than non-property tax owners. You know, we own property, yes we do. We own businesses, yes we do. But we pay a tremendous amount of property taxes. And, you know, to just put it on a select group and say that that's where the problem is, if you look at the budget, clearly the numbers do not justify that. Every single year that he has budgeted property tax revenue, he has brought in that number and more. So tell me why the property tax owners have to bear the burden of us overspending on our budget every year consistently. If you look at these numbers that come from the state website, consistently over and over and over, we have over budgeted. Another play on words. In the memo, it says budget requests were cut by 2%. I don't care what they requested, and I don't care that they were cut by 2%. Your actual expenditures need to be what's cut. He says overall the budget is decreased by 4%. But as county commissioners, you know, you increased the budget from the adopted budget last year by almost 3%. So the real number is 1% in the decrease in expenditures. So, you know, it's a play on words. Listen carefully. I implore you to look at these numbers. Look at the highlighted numbers that I have here. For sales tax, these have steadily and dramatically dropped. So if you look at them,
he's recommending a increase in sales tax revenue that I don't understand, and he's a very brilliant man. I'm sure that his staff has worked very, very hard on this budget, but I don't see why we're already budgeting for the upcoming year a 3% increase in sales tax. I think we're setting ourselves up to also not get that revenue next year. So when you look at the property taxes, you look at the actual sales tax decreases, which, what does that tell you? It tells you everybody out here on the street is spending less, but our county government is spending more every single year consistently. And if you look at the bottom numbers, which are on the last page, we were in the green in 2006. 2007, we were in the green by over $1 million. 2008, we were in the green by $2.3 million. We had many administrative changes between 08 and 09. Immediately in 09, we had a $3 million loss, $4 million loss, $4.1 million, which we don't even have that budgeted. You're budgeting for things, for revenues that we know we're not going to have. Our sheriff's department has, I feel like, done an excellent job. But revenues from some of those sources did not come in, did not pan out. When you look at the revenues for beer and wine tax, they went from $250,000 to $78,000 in 2010. When you look at expenditures for the total expenditures decreasing, what happened in 2007 that made total expenditures grow by over 10%? The total budget grew by 10%. So revenues grew less than 7%. Where was that money coming from? I mean, I know when I balance my checkbook, I look to see how much is in my checking account before I write the check. So, I mean, these numbers do not lie. And if there's something that I'm misreading, I would love for somebody to explain it to me. But I mean, it's simple math. You know, I have a master's degree. It's not in math, but I think I can read these numbers, and I think you guys can too, and see that there's got to be some other solution other than property tax increases. They're recommending a total budget of $142 million, but according to the proposed budget, we anticipate revenues that don't even meet that right now. So where does that money come from? I mean, I know we have an anticipation that we're going to make more money this year than we did last year, but even with a tax increase, it doesn't look like you're going to make the budget for next year. So, you know, we're already setting ourselves up to be short in revenues for next year. So, you know, we've overspent $4.4 million. Our fund balance would be fine had we not overspent that money. Sales tax has a direct correlation to our local economy, and you should see that consistently consumers are spending less, and we have not adjusted for that. We are not only spending our budgeted expenditures, but we're overspending and borrowing money to do it. $10 million. I came to the county commissioners meeting 2 years ago, and everyone sat right here. I remember specifically, I got up and I said, you know, I would love to be able to pay my bills tomorrow, but I have to schedule those loans out for as long as the bank will give me. And in order to save less than 1% interest, we chose to have an early payout, which resulted in a 3 cent increase in property taxes. How is that fair to the taxpayer? You know, I'd love to be able to pay all my bills tomorrow, but I can't do it, so I schedule my payments out. We can look at debt reallocation and refinancing our debt. We can look at lowering the discount rate, and after talking to the staff today, I think they already have plans to do that in the upcoming year to bring in more revenue from property tax sales. But I really believe that raising property taxes isn't the answer. Thank you for hearing me. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Jennifer.
Thank you.
Anyone else on the front row? How about the second row? How about the third row? We'll be where I can't see people. How about the fourth row? Welcome, sir.
My name is Kyle Buckner. I'm the chief of the Alamance County Risk Unit. And I hadn't really planned on speaking a little bit tonight. But seeing that, for those of you that don't know a little bit about what we are, we're an all-volunteer, not emergency services in the county.
We have about 65 members in our organization. And I've seen that outside agencies will possibly cut by 60%. We have a limited budget just like everyone else and operate primarily on donations. Work very closely with the EMS agency in the county, and they work closely with us. Very fortunate to be part of the emergency services in this county and provide a lot of different specialized operations throughout the county, as heavy vehicle and machinery education, water rescue, including dive and swift water, canine search and rescue, confined space, rope rescue, and also provide backup EMS or ambulance service to the county EMS agency. Also, we provide all the medical standbys throughout the county when requested by whether it be a company, citizens, or other nonprofit organizations. And we also provide a rehab system for the county fire departments in the entire county in case of a structure fire, any major incident that may be occurring, to keep those firefighters and other emergency services workers safe and hopefully turn home safely. We're just asking that everybody look at that budget and try to cut us at the minimum possible, because we have a lot of equipment, just like the fire departments do, that need to be updated and kept in service. The county does work with us very closely through EMS to maintain our ambulances and to provide us with a lot of our medical equipment and update on that, which is great, and we thank them a lot for that. But we still have a lot of rescue equipment that is getting outdated, such as like the air packs that the fire departments talked about. We have a bunch of air packs as well for confined space operations, and they are getting, actually they're outdated, but however, in the grants that we have put in for, we have been denied on all the grants we put in for to replace those type of items. So we're just asking that you look closely at your budget and see if it's any way to cut us at the minimal possible so that we can keep our equipment in satisfactory condition, and hopefully we can replace some of our equipment so that our members will be safe and be able to return home to their families. So I just ask that you look at that very closely and take into consideration that 6% cut. Thank you.
Thank you, Kyle. On the row where Kyle is returning, are there other folks that would like to speak? About the row right behind Kyle. About the row right behind that row. Yes, good evening, come forward. Welcome.
Hi, my name is Jane Wilson. I live in the southern part of Alamance County. I also would like to not see an increase in the property taxes. I would like to see the budget trimmed down more. I worked in the private sector, and I received bonus pay or longevity pay, but we had to put a cap on it or a ceiling on it when I worked because it got out of hand. And I think that's something maybe the county needs to look at. $900,000 is a lot of money. Also, I paid for part of my insurance in the private sector, and I think that's something you could look at. There's a lot of people that haven't had a raise since 2008. If that means raising the property tax, then keep the salary like it is. I just think that the people that have to pay the property tax have to shoulder most of the monies, and it's very hard. I have the budget for myself, and I have the times are not very good now. I've had to work on my own budget and trim down things, and I just think that the county budget needs to be less instead of more. And I'm not for this property tax, and I thank you for my time.
Thank you, Ms. Wilson. Other speakers on the row where Ms. Wilson is returning? About the row behind where Ms. Wilson is. Are there other rows behind that row? Anyone else on this side of the room? Yes, sir. Come forward. Welcome.
Appreciate it. It's a pleasure to meet each and every one of you. And I tell you, each one of you have a tough job. We're not here to lambast you. I know you've got a job to do. Your job almost year-round concerns spending my money and these people's money.
Can you introduce yourself to the group?
Oh, I'm sorry. My name is Carl Leslie Temple. For the first 26 years, I was known as Leslie, and after that, they started calling me Carl because it was pronounced Carl a little bit better. But, you know, we each have a budget, and we've heard budget all of our life. But the way I see it, if we have $128 million, oh, it's real simple. We say, Mr. County Manager, we've got $128 million. I don't know how many department heads you've got, but each one of them, you got to talk to them face to face and say, ladies and gentlemen, this is the amount of money we have. I can't go ask for any more money. We've got a lot of senior citizens in this county. The average person in Alamance County on Social Security makes $700 a month. That's their check. A lot of them live in mill houses. The tax value on the mill house is probably $55,000. Okay, that's roughly $500, $600 a year with the city and county tax. That's almost one of their monthly checks. It doesn't sound like much when you say 2 cents on the 100, but if you're on a fixed income, it is. And I reiterate what a couple of these ladies said. They said it much better than I can say it, especially the first lady. She seemed to have her I's dotted and the T's crossed. You know, we've got a transit authority over here. They brag about 70,000 trips a year. They don't tell you they don't have nobody but the driver in part of them. I've watched it for the last 3 or 4 years. You can be anywhere in the city limits of Burlington, out far as Scott's Clinic. $2.70 will get you a ride to Scott's Clinic if you're a senior citizen. Now, you tell me how you can do that with a vehicle that gets 4 miles to the gallon. You got to pay that person, lady or man, something, $8, $12 an hour. I don't know what they pay them. These people, I think, get about $140,000 for us. That would hire 3 county employees, wouldn't it? Maybe 4. I don't see why we need to give Transit Authority any money. And if the city of Burlington comes through with the bus system that some of you may have read in the paper about, we've got a handful of people that wants a bus system there. Well, the Transit Authority, what are they going to do about that? We don't need to give them $140,000. And as far as the county employees, let me tell you, I think this county probably has some of the best. We have the best county commissioners, ladies and gentlemen. But merit pay, when you come to work for a company, you agree that day you come to work what you're going to work for. If you don't do your job, you need to be fired. Just because you did that job to the end of the year, you don't deserve merit pay. You agreed that you would work for X number of dollars and that you would do a good job for that amount of money. And that's what you're supposed to do. Longevity pay? Why do we give people longevity pay? There may have been a time that that was an incentive to keep employees so that we wouldn't have to keep hiring employees and wasting money. I don't know of companies now that give longevity pay. And we were said that was $900,000. That's a, what's that, 1 penny on this to add to the 52 cents. So, you know, you ladies and gentlemen have got a tough job. It's easy for us as taxpayers to come up here and say a lot to you because we're not set behind, we're not sitting in your position. You know, the old song many years ago, out walk a mile in my shoes before you criticize and abuse. There's a lot to that. And I admire each one of you, and each one done a good job. I read in the paper every day what you've done and what you have to say about the situations, and I admire each one of you. But there again, to me, if we've got $128 million, that's what we got to work with. There's cases that we have gentlemen and ladies driving Suburbans when they could be driving an S10 truck. We have some crews that have dual-wheel drive trucks when just a regular truck might do. So these department heads have got to get together and do the best they can. Maybe they already are, I'm not sure. Now some of them have a pretty good wish list. You know, it's nice to have power windows in a car, but what's wrong with roll up and down windows? You know, we got to get back to the basics. Look at what's happening in this country. The stock market the other day dropped 274 points. I think it dropped a few points again today. Look at the foreign countries. We're in a bad state, and I'm thankful for you county commissioners that Alamance County's pretty doggone good shape. We're not like these other counties. I don't like to be compared to other counties. I don't want another county person to come here and tell us how to run this county either. You're doing a pretty good job yourself. We really appreciate it. Y'all have a good week.
Thank you, Mr. Temple. Before we go to this side of the room, I forgot to mention that logistically, we do have restrooms in this building. If you need to leave, they're down the steps and back that way. Tim, is that right? In the basement, down two floors and then to the other end of the building. Feel free to come and go as you need to. Okay, let's turn to this side of the room now on the lower level and see if anybody in the first row would like to speak. That would be you, Mr. Webster. Hearing none, how about the second row? Mr. Moser, welcome to you.
Thank you, Chairman Manning. Commissioners, thank you for the opportunity to speak, and I appreciate all the hard work you do and the challenges you try to meet.
Can you introduce yourself to the crowd?
Pardon?
Can you introduce yourself to the crowd?
Oh, yes, sir. I'm sorry. I'm Sammy Moser. I've been a taxpayer for quite a few years in Alamance County. I've lived here all my life, and I have paid in quite a lot of taxes, and happy to be able to pay the taxes. But I am concerned as a taxpayer about discussion about a possible property tax increase. That is a concern, not only for me, but for young teenagers and youngsters coming along who are going to be our future taxpayers. One thing I wanted to ask is, I did want to make a comment. I read the newspaper this morning, and I was sort of taken back by some of the strong comments directed towards Mr. Honeycutt, because I thought he'd been trying to do a good job working with the budget, and I remember him asking our commissioners at several meetings for direction, several different times, on how to handle this budget process. So I just want to speak on behalf of our county manager. I thought maybe he got chastised a little bit too much, just my personal thinking. But I want to ask our commissioners, before you vote on the budget this year, please know exactly what you're voting on in the budget. Make sure we know what we're giving out money to. I kind of agree with Ms. Talley, I think it is. I think we do have a spending issue, and maybe not necessarily a revenue issue. It looks like over the past 4 years, we have increased giving out money nearly $1 million per year. At the same time, we're telling our county employees that we don't have money to afford a salary increase for them. According to figures I have, we have increased the county debt, and Mr. Honeycutt, correct me if I'm wrong, $15 million over the last 3 years. Somewhere in that range, we have increased the debt. In a recession, nearly $15 million. We have increased the yearly debt payment by $2,200,000. And this happened, I suppose, our county commissioner board has to vote on these spending issues. So, again, I think we've got a spending issue, and I want hopefully you'll consider that. Through the years, we've given quite a lot of money to corporations, incentive issues, Honda Equipment, Tri-Vantage, NiPro, LabCorp, Continental Components. They may still owe us $60,000, I'm not sure. They left the county. Ferrara Foods, Sandvik Corporation, Honda Aero, just to name a few. It appears that we can give money to large corporations, but what are we doing to help our average working taxpayer? And I wonder, what is our review policy directed to these companies that we give money to as far as their benchmark? Do we really have a good review policy that we're reviewing and making sure they hire the number of employees that the benchmark require? Is that happening? If not, I would like to ask our commissioners to direct our county manager to make sure this is taking place, because there could be a lot of money at issue with some of these businesses who have received incentives. I hope all these companies that have received incentives through the years are hiring the people who they say they would be hiring. I noticed that in an old news article, the Times News had reported that Honda Arrow would hire 80 new employees, that's 80 employees, by the end of 2011. And by the end of 2012, they will have hired 110 employees at an average salary of $62,000 plus benefits. So if that's taking place, that should bring a lot of revenues to Alamance County. If it's not taking place, they're failing to meet their benchmarks. So that's something I'd like for our commissioners to, let's please look into all these companies. We spend a lot of time trying to give money to Burlington Technologies. They didn't even have contracts to open their business, but we spent right much time, and time is money. And so I don't know, have they ever opened their business to hire the 100 employees? They were gonna hire 100 employees in March. So I'd like to ask our commissioners to consider, until such time as we improve our reserve fund, our budget, that we consider eliminating giving money to corporations. I know Commissioner Sutton has been opposed to that for some time, and I appreciate that. So just something I'd like to ask you, Commissioner, to please consider. To save money, very few businesses offer pension plans and longevity pay. Very few companies do that. Both appear to be out of hand in Alamance County. Neither do business, or most businesses, pay insurance premiums after retirement. I think Alamance County continues to do this. In all fairness to our current employees, I would not suggest making any changes that's already in effect, but I would ask the commissioners to consider implementing new employment policies with new employees, possibly to save taxpayers money. The longevity pay and paid insurance after retirement should not be included in new job packages. I'd ask you to consider that. We have, according to what I read in the paper, I think our county manager and our county department's heads have done a good job cutting their budget over the last couple of years. It seems like it's the outside agencies for the funding increases has continued. So one department that has not been cut, and this is going to go contradictory to what our volunteer firemen are saying, I don't think we've requested any volunteer fire departments to reduce their budget by 2% or whatever. That's just something to think about. And I commend all the volunteer firemen. They do a great job. It's a great service. But when you say volunteers, there used to be fish fries and barbecues and fundraisers to actually help raise money. And I don't know if we ever do that anymore, but it just seems like volunteer fire departments, they just go to the commissioners and raise their property tax again. I'm not disputing that they're not needed. I'm not quite sure. But I just think we ask all the other departments to cut their budget. Maybe we should consider taking 2 cents from each volunteer fire department, tax revenue, return that into the county, the general budget, at least until we get over this sort of crisis that we're in, financial crisis. It's just something I want to discuss. To prevent from raising property taxes, I think the commissioner should request the ABSS return $2 million from their $21 million reserve fund. I think you commissioners discussed doing something or doing this over a year ago, and no action was taking place. So I'd suggest you direct to Mr. Honeycutt, let's take some action in this area. As a concerned taxpayer, I'm also asking for direction on the budget. I think Mr. Honeycutt's asked for that. I'm just asking, please, let's look at every area that we can work in and not continue to raise property taxes. And again, thank you so much for the time speaking. Thank you for your work.
Thank you, Mr. Moser. Anyone else on the second row? Mr. Vines, welcome. Please introduce yourself to the crowd.
Thank you, Commissioner. My name is Henry Vines, and I am from the Snow Camp area. Commissioners, I have tonight some recommendations that I'd like to make to you. I have looked over the budget, and it did concern me that we have several departments here that have increases. We have been told that we're going to reduce each department by 2%. I have several departments here that I have pulled out of the budget, and I'll just give y'all a copy of this so you'll have it. First of all is the county manager's office, a 10.6% increase. If we reduce that to 2% of last year's budget, that would be a savings of $162,058. Human resources up 1.1%, $19,242. The district attorney's office up 38.1%, $2,667. The Board of Elections is up 41.7%. I understand why that's up this year, but if you cut their budget from last year, it would equal to $10,000 at 2%. The Register's Deeds is up 12.9%, $86,382. Printing and Services up 12.7%, $31,586. Public Buildings up 7.1%, $125,084. This total's amount is $437,019. Then we get down to our law enforcement area. Sheriff's Department up 3.7%. The 2% cut would be $529,380. School Resource Officers up 7%, $33,399. Jail up 3.1%, $442,391. Animal Shelter up 2.9%, $13,687. A total of $1,018,857. Add these two together, that's $1,455,876. We come down to the health, and I'm not sure, and Mr. Honeycutt, you probably, these increases on health, or is these for the health insurance?
Yes, sir.
So I understand where these needs are got to be done because we've cut those, and we've used $2.2 million worth of fund balance last year out of that fund. We cannot continue that. I understand that. Dental care program, I guess that's in the same thing. Social services, 3.7 increase. That's $1,151,670. Outside agencies, we're currently giving that Alamance County Chamber of Commerce $112,847. Tourist Development Authority. Not sure what that is, $320,000. Burlington Alamance Airport Authority, $255,034. Piedmont Triad Partnership, $15,175. If we cut these four outside agency out, that would equal to $703,056. Historical Museum, $77,000. Sword of Peace, $10,340. Arts Association of Alamance County, $4,513. If these were eliminated, that's another $133,123. On our outside agencies, according to what's been reported, we've had a 37% increase over the last 4 years. If we could cut that back 40%, we could save $1,417,991. A total savings of $3,710,046. Commissioners, these are suggestions that I think you should look at. Certainly, I don't have all the intel of what each one of these departments may or may not need, but I know that this is over 2.5 cents worth of property taxes. Also, the other thing that I would like for you to consider is that the cost of living raise that you are projecting to give. I think you should set this cost of living at a set rate of $600, which is based on 2% of a $30,000 a year job. It's not fair that a $100,000 job gets $2,000 and a $30,000 a year job only gets $600. This would save our county money and give each employee a raise, a cost of living raise, which would be fair and even to everyone. Not only that, they will be receiving a 1.3% increase in salary, because if you give them back their 3 days that you have taken from them for the last 3 years, that will be an increase in salary for them of 1.3%. Other areas that I think we should look at, we have discussed this, it's been discussed among y'all in the past, is the closing of the old jail. I think this is going to cost us money. We have took on contracts that for non-felon inmates at $40 a day. It's been reported it costs us $42 a day to keep them. That's not very good economics. I think Mr. Huntington put in $600,000 into revenues for that. I think this is an area that maybe you need to look at. By closing this, it could be impossible as much as $2 to $3 million of savings there. And on the cars, I think we need to, it's time for us to stop affording luxuries, some that we can't afford at this time. Reduce the fleet of cars. Pull the cars back in from being drove home. We wouldn't need as many cars. We'd save all the gas that's going backwards and forwards. This would be a cut that could help us. And also, I like, as Jennifer has already said, how solid is our revenues? These projections that we have done, of increases of 3% on sales tax, I read a report saying that it makes no difference who gets president next year. They're looking that we're going to go backwards in 2013. I hope not. But we cannot keep hoping and wishing on prayers of things getting better. We need to spend, like the other gentleman said, we need to spend what we've got. And I just wanted to mention, I know you mentioned the fees. We had a substantial increase in fees last year. This year, we got the same increase again. This is on all, our services, our inspection departments, our water, our health departments. All these are showing increases. Commissioners, these are just things that I have seen myself that we can make cuts. I ask for you to this year, as you go through the budget, to lay everything out on the table. And when you pass this year's budget, I don't want to hear the comment saying, well, I think we had more cuts we can make. I want you to make all the cuts that you can make this year, set that budget, and require that budget to be met. We don't need to be in the red when it's through and done. I would like to make a comment on the fire tax. I'm not sure if Mr. Fuqua got his information about my $162, but I can assure you that's one. I have about five of them. My chicken house is $162, but all my other stuff is a whole lot more than that. The increase that was received by the fire department last year was $152,061. That's what the tax increase generated, according to what's in the manager's book here. $40,000 is for the air packs. When it was presented at the budget, it was said that they needed this whole 2 cent to buy our air pack budgets, and I may have misunderstood. I understood them say it was $120,000 and that this would pay for their packs in 1 year. So where did the other $112,000 go? All other departments are handling their increases in insurances, their increases in other things by doing a good job. Our fire chief rides around in a $60,000 Chevrolet Tahoe with no markings on it. Don't think that's right. If I'm paying for it, I want to see it's mine. And I'd appreciate y'all's consideration on this. It's not that I have anything against our fire department. They do a wonderful job. There's one other thing that I would like for you as commissioners to look into. It's my understanding that when the fire tax was issued by legislation, that it was put a 6 cent cap per $100 put on that. I would like for y'all to find out if that 6 cents is still in place and are we over what was legislated to be presented to be done, or have they increased it, or what is that? But this is what I have been told, that when this was passed, that it would be a 6 cents per 100. This was established to help our fire departments, our volunteer fire departments, so that they wouldn't have to struggle so hard to get money in doing fundraisers and such. This was never intended to have a funded fire department. If we're going to have a funded fire department in Alamance County, maybe it's time we move to a countywide fire department. There's over $4.5 million generated in Alamance County fire departments, volunteer fire departments. That's a pretty good sizable amount of money. I'd appreciate y'all's input on this, and again, gentlemen, let's leave it on the table. I think their cuts are here, if you're willing to make them, and we will not have to raise taxes this year. Thank you.
Thank you, Henry.
Thank you, Henry. Anyone else on second row? Third row. Mark, we don't want a lot of rebuttals here. As I said, this is a public hearing. It's not a public debate.
I'm here as a taxpayer.
Okay. Then, in that case, welcome and introduce yourself.
I want to speak on behalf of people talking about cuts and cuts and cuts. You know, people want us to cut, but when they need the services, they want them there. They expect for you to respond. That's like you're talking about EMS. How many people in this room know how many days a week we run out of ambulance? Do you know how many days a week?
Every day.
I mean, it's every day we run out of ambulance. We have to depend on outside agencies. I know the day I needed them, I'm glad that they were there. I wouldn't be here today. Sheriff's Department, you don't know how good it feels when you go on an EMS call and there's a shooting, stabbing. I remember many years ago, You was by yourself. Now every deputy, and you go on a call, is there behind you. So I don't like paying taxes neither. But everybody sitting here and talks about cut. But if we keep cutting, when something happens, that person expects the same services that you get when you make that cut. And I said, I know there's a time you got to try to get things balanced, but you know, that's all I hear is cut. And we got to move forward. I know if you cut me 2 cents, I'll have to shut my fire department down because I can't pay my bills. So it just, and it's other fire departments the same way. And that's all I wanted to speak on. I want to speak on behalf of the EMS, law enforcement, fire service, that and the people that are asking for a 2% increase in raise in the county. I know EMS, they were going to have to take and cut $100,000 to be able to get a 2%. There's things I hear, and I'm not here for Chucky trying to make him look good neither. It's just, I know they stay busy, law enforcement stays busy, we stay busy. I just want to come up here and not hit you on cut, but just, thank you.
Thank you, Mark. Anyone else on the third row?
Yes, I'm sure I remember. Speech.
Welcome.
My name is Jack Collins. I've been retired for 20 years, and I happen to live in Cobra Township, which is notorious for people coming and complaining. They complain about everything. No solution, I won't complain. And I have heard nothing but fire for anything about our air pack. Two guys right there. They complain all the time about it. If they need us, they'd be the first one to call. You know, you can do away with the sheriff's department, fire department. What are you going to do about services? The tax money is for services. Ask the people that bitch and whine about what they wanted about taxes, ask them what they want to do without. Let them do that. Has anybody said what they'd like to do without? I don't know one. You got a woman, husband gets drunk, come home, beat tar out of her. Suppose she had to cut off some of the deputies, let her wait about an hour before you call the sheriff is there. House goes up smoke. Fire department got no firemen. They ain't coming. Said there's H with you. So, you know, I heard a lot of complaints. Hadn't heard no solutions yet.
Thank you, sir. How about the next row? John, welcome to you. Please introduce yourself to the group.
This stuff is no fun, is it? Let me just say this. My name is John Oakes. I'm from Burlington. I hate public speaking. I am here occasionally, but I really detest it. I'm not comfortable here. Before I give my little 4-minute speech, I was thinking about the 3 minutes I tried to keep in that. If you haven't donned a CBA yet, if you haven't rode in an ambulance, let me encourage you to do so. I spent a couple of years as a volunteer fireman. If I'd have been younger, I would have pursued it, but I didn't get into it until I was my mid-30s, and that was a long time ago. I can tell you at 2 in the morning, nobody will care about the tax rate when it comes to fire and police. It's easy to criticize your department heads in these services, but I went to firefighter 1 school, rookie school, did the whole thing, EMT for 6 years. And I did it as a paid guy too at one time, but I did it mostly as a volunteer. And I can tell you why most people aren't volunteering for it, because the guys that do this are very seldom recognized. Listen to your chiefs. Either tell them, get you a new chief, or trust your chief. if he's telling you something, because EMS, fire, and police are services that our government's designed to provide for people. And that was unprepared. So, but tonight I would like to just start with thank you for the opportunity to speak, but and I have mine written, so I'll stay on task, and it should be less than 4 minutes. It was Ben Franklin that said, any fool can criticize, condemn, and complain, and most fools do. It is not my intent to criticize, condemn, or complain this evening, but to reason with each of you and everyone in goodwill and respectfully. I am grateful for the opportunity to speak this evening, even if I do hate it. I spent approximately 2 weeks reviewing and studying the 243-page budget in an effort to be an informed citizen and not an irrational one. Thanks to Mr. Honeycutt, they provided me with a copy. I didn't even have to pay for it. I got to use it for a few days and about 2 weeks, and I returned it. Like most folks, I'm an average citizen concerned about the future of our children. That is my motive and reason for being here this evening. No hidden agenda, not looking to be popular or on TV or any of that stuff. I hate it. A few weeks ago, I sent each of you and Mr. Honeycutt an email asking for your consideration pertaining to this year's budget. Each of you has my email, so I don't intend to repeat my suggestions pertaining to the budget publicly, but I hope if you haven't read it, you will and give it consideration. Last year when I was here, I explained that we were in a false economy stimulated by borrowing and that it would take years for our economy to adjust and that it would involve financial hardship and sacrifice by everyone. I encouraged everyone not to expect financial conditions to improve significantly within the next 5 years, and I explained the data supports that reason. I ask you to consider that we were just kicking the can down the road and balancing our budget if it involved using the fund balance. Even though I acknowledge that the purpose of the fund balance is to make up deficits in spending. Once again, unfortunately, we were overly optimistic last year in creating a budget that turned out to be seriously flawed. That ended up in us having to use $4,465,679 of our fund balance in 2011. The same thing happened in 2010. The deficit was $3,946,799. And in 2009, it was $3,109,949. I can tell you, you did have a positive surplus over a 10-year period about 3 or 4 years, if I remember correctly. But aggregately, over the 10-year period, you had a deficit aggregately over that 10 years of about 600,000 to 700,000. I don't remember the number exactly. There are many people who will come before you using terms like invest in our future when it comes to suggesting that you should increase spending when it pertains to the budget. No doubt they are sincere in most cases. But there is no question that to continue to kick the can down the road and justify it using any language is being irresponsible financially. I would like to suggest that even though we have a fund balance to use for deficits, wouldn't the prudent position be that we create a budget annually as if we don't have a fund balance? And that we keep the fund balance at the minimum of 8% of what North Carolina State recommends requires. I couldn't figure out if that was a requirement or if it was just a recommendation. Isn't it reasonable to state that when we have governments maintaining any type of savings account, no matter what we name it, in this case fund balance, if we are honest, isn't that just another way that government taxes its citizens and promotes, unintentionally, spending beyond our means? Doesn't having this type of government savings account that's been created from taxpayer wallets provide an incentive to be overly optimistic each year when it comes to creating a budget? I suggest it does. I respectfully request that one of you make a motion and then vote in agreement to instruct Mr. Honeycutt to provide a balanced budget to you this year that does not increase our tax rate, that will provide a pay raise for deserving employees, and that will not require using any fund balance. Private sector, board of directors, CEO, go to your department heads. If you gotta lay people off, here's what we want accomplished. Everyone doesn't deserve a raise every year just because they've been in on a job. That is very unpopular when you look at Alamance County numbers, and between Burlington, Alamance County, and the city government, that's 5,235 people, according to the Alamance County Area Chamber of Commerce, which represents they are in the top 10. But I have a lot of friends that are in government. They do a lot of great work. I mean, this is difficult, but we have got to run government like we want run private business. And I'll get off my soapbox. If you do this, aren't you truly balancing the budget and planning for the future prudently and responsibly? Wouldn't that be the right thing to do? For the struggling taxpayers who are paying the bills, and for the future of our children and grandchildren, I suggest it is, and I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak. Thank you.
Thank you, John.
Thank you, John. Anyone else on the row where John's sitting? How about the row behind John? See rumblings. Come forward, Ms. Vaughn. Good evening.
Good evening, commissioners. Mine may be short.
Can you introduce yourself to the crowd, please?
I'm Ann Vaughn.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I agreed a lot with what Mr. Oates had to say, and several other people, Jennifer also. We have a problem. I hope we do not hurt our employees any more than we have in the last couple of years. I think that and strongly believe that our projections have been wrong. They've just been wrong. And I think that's led us into a lot of problems, and that's happened within the last 2 to 3 years. This has been going on, and we've hit that fund balance, and we can't keep doing it. We must decide how we will become solvent. Don't raise taxes, not on property taxes, please. We must do something to become solvent, and we must be sustainable, and this is really what I want to say. I know there are other cuts, and one of the worst situations that we've had recently, everybody talks about cuts, 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 and on the national level, they turned around and cut out the Social Security office and said, well, our folks can go to Guilford County or Caswell County, Orange County. It's only 30 miles down the road. Well, I'm a senior, but I'm not in that bad a situation yet. But I hate driving to Greensboro or Orange County or anywhere else. That Social Security office down there is a service to our people, and it should be maintained or brought back. So I know we have a meeting on Wednesday morning to do just that. So this is what we're talking about when you start talking about cuts, and that's a good example. And who are we hurting when we talk about cuts? In that case, it's the seniors. So we don't want to hurt our seniors. We don't want to hurt education. We don't want to hurt our employees. I do suggest that looking at the benefits that are available to our employees now, I don't know if that's a contract. We certainly don't want to get in trouble breaking the contract. But I do suggest that we really look at future hires. And what are we going to do there? They have, you know, county employees have great, great benefits here and something to be proud of, but do we take that away? I don't know that we can. Honestly, don't know that we can. So I suggest that we do something and we work hard to rebuild our fund balance where it was, and that we do something that is sustainable. Good luck, guys. Thank you.
Thank you, Ann. Anyone else on the road where Ann is?
Carmen?
Good evening, sir.
Thank you. That's good information. I was really, I got my mind up not speaking. And then somebody stood up and inferred a word. Since I've been moved, reinforced by the Marine Corps, and then as an adult, I'm late. Change ain't a word. I was taught that. When it comes to cut, I may not be proper English, but if you sit up there with the attitude, you can't cut, or if you're told, I can't cut, don't believe. Don't believe. A little bit of shock. Pulled my truck up back there, looked up there, said 596 Frisco burger. I said, I don't know what is a Frisco burger, but it's got to be something to be 596. I guess I'm a dinosaur. I remember going out there on 49 to that place long, long ago, 10 hot dogs for a dollar. I was in Hog Heaven. I don't know if nobody remembers that place.
Mr. Hope.
So I know things have turned, okay? So let me show you what. This is not a good example for kids. Let me show you what poor folks have to do when they come up against taxes. I don't know what carton cigarettes cost no more because they put all this tax on it. But when I get the tax, I had to do something because Joel couldn't quit smoking. I tried. Doesn't give me a heart attack, they say. I don't think it did. But, and thigh bypass. This cigarette right here, I was, when that taxes went up, I started rolling my own. Well, you think, well, you go over there, some Park Plaza, $13.99 for the back, a pound. Now, that's not cigarette tobacco. That's the rich people. That's pipe tobacco. Pipe tobacco, see, people smoked pipes, had pulls, so they didn't put the tax on it. The difference is the cut. Pipe tobacco is cut longer. $3 and something carton for the cube. So I get about three cartons of cigarettes for $22, $23. That's what taxes do to me. See, I get faced with it. You say, okay, all I gotta do is give it, show another tax out there. Well, you're getting down to where the only thing I know to do is give up the 596 hamburgers, which you never got in the first place, and start eating roadkill. I mean, I'll survive. I'm just asking y'all to do the same life. I mean, I'm gonna survive till I die. Everybody say, you live, born, live, pay taxes, and die. By God, give us a break from taxes. We need fine. They can't. They said, I can't afford to smoke no more. I figured out a way to smoke.
Thank you, Ed. Thank you for sharing. Anybody else on the row where Ann and Eddie are? How about the row behind that row, Wilbur's row? But in the last row, welcome, come forward. Good evening.
Good evening. I'm Allison Gant with Alamance Citizens for Education, and I'm not really sure how to follow roadkill and tobacco, but I'm going to try. It seems that all communities today are certainly facing an economic challenge when it comes to their budget, and we here in Alamance County are certainly no different. I want to commend Mr. Honeycutt for his proposed budget. It's been a difficult and challenging time. When you watch the reports of the county budget that's been proposed and the response from both the county commissioners and our community, we have to begin to ask the question, what are and where are our priorities? Now, I look at this a little differently than most people in this room. But when we look at how a community treats its elderly and its children, it reflects the character and its priorities of that community. Here, the leaders in our county continue to wrangle with those tough decisions, but we must ask, what do we do for the greater good? Recent articles in the paper reflecting those positions of both elected officials and the public are certainly not lacking. And sometimes I wonder if truly everyone understands the full information. For me, I don't read budgets great, but I do my best to attempt. When it comes to a vibrant economic center, which is what we hope Alamance County is or will be, we look at several factors. And for those interested in the area, they're going to look at these factors as well, such as how business friendly is our government, is the county's government? Does it offer and support services that are vital? Is there an available workforce? What is the educational attainment of the community? And does it offer an education to its people that will support the needs of business and industry? Each year, the argument comes up about whether or not to raise property taxes, to instill other types of taxes, or to create additional revenues in different ways. It certainly is a difficult decision. But every year, sometimes I feel like the community focuses on pennies. And what do I mean by pennies? As a simple example of the current proposed tax increase, if you look at on an average median home in our county is about $150,000. Now, if you apply that 2.5 cent tax rate, it really comes out to $37.50 per year. When you divide that out on a monthly basis, it's $3.13, and down to a daily rate of 11 cents. It seems to me that this small amount is worth a greater gain for the better and the good. We certainly don't want to blame any one department or person, and it's certainly not for political gain. It is truly all about the greater good. When it comes to the future of Alamance County, we must not allow our children to be the losers. As, for instance, in the education arena, as the tax continue to come down both from federal and state, and the possibility of additional local budget allocations, it's frightening. Our children, our future, deserve better. Our school system has done a tremendous job in being financially responsive to the budget crisis. And I would like to simply note that its fund balance does not stand at $21 million. It stands at approximately $12 million. Simply put, education must not and should not be the place where this community continues to cut. The current budget proposed by the system is the simple ask of restoration of funds that were taken back last year. If your job is to oversee our county and to preserve all services to this community, and if 11 cents a day helps our community to achieve the necessary revenue to help our local economy grow, then there should really be no question. Thank you for your time.
Thanks, Allison. Anyone in the balcony wish to speak? How about over here on the left-hand side? Right-hand side? Anyone, any corner of the room I missed? If not, we'll entertain a motion that the public hearing be closed.
Make the motion.
Thank you, Eddie. Is there a second? Thank you, Bill. Any discussion about the public hearing being closed? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. And thanks to each of you for your input. Thanks to each of you for your listening and for your respect of those who were speaking. I'd like to now turn to the next item on the agenda, which is the discussion of the fiscal year budget. I'd like to begin by allowing our county manager just to briefly summarize where we were the last time we met with respect to the recommended budget. And we talked in terms of the major variables affecting the budget, which included the potential change in the tax rate, the proposed cuts, county departments, outside agencies, and any adjustment to staff compensation. So if we can start there, and if you can briefly just comment, then we'll turn it open to our commission.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. One thing I do want to mention before I begin is Susan handed me a note, and she reiterated that if we pass if there's any discussion about passing a budget this evening, it does have to include Fawcett. So we cannot pass a tax rate without Fawcett being included at tonight.
I'm sorry, I missed without doing what?
Including the Fawcett Fire District.
Their request.
So that has to be approved all.
Well, we didn't do that with Hall River one year that we were up here.
You get into a lot of back and forth. If you can approve it all at one time, you can't set it and then go back and change it.
Say it again.
You can't set the, would be able to set Fawcett and then go back and change it at a later date once the budget ordinance has been passed.
Could we take them out of the budget and then pass them at a later date?
I'd have to check the budget model.
Clyde?
I think you could.
Okay.
Yeah, I think we did that with River last year or something.
Okay, I just wanted to clarify that before we.
It would be like any other amendment to the budget, wouldn't it?
Right.
Well, when you set the tax rate, it is set for the year.
Right, we'd have to live within that constraint, right. But we could still adjust any line item in the budget.
Right. We just wanted to make, and I apologize for having this conversation, just wanted to make sure that we were all, and Clyde was okay with the direction of that. So we can, if the board decides to make any changes tonight in approving the budget, you can take Fawcett out, and we can have a motion on Fawcett at the next meeting.
But we can't change the proposed tax rate if it's passed tonight.
Right, we can't change it. Yeah, if we approve Fawcett tonight, we can't go back and change it.
No, I understand that, but I think the confusion is when you say the tax rate, you're talking about the tax rate at Fawcett.
Right.
Okay.
Normally, when you approve the budget, you approve the tax rate and also the tax rates for the fire.
Correct. Right.
But we're going to pull them out, right?
Right. Okay. We wanted to make sure of is that you can exempt Fawcett at this time. You're not approving Fawcett.
Okay.
Request that would be done at a later date.
And when that is done, that's not going to change right. The overall tax rate right. If it's voted on tonight.
Yes. Only
okay. Yes, that's kind
okay.
Of.
I apologize for the confusion on that. The manager's budget that we have seen and that we've had workshops on is really a very straightforward budget, and it included really four major components. We looked at 2% cut to departments. Again, some departments were not cut 2% because we're budgeting on actuals from the year before. Some of those line items that we budget or departments that we budgeted actual this year, we're going to have to go back and go through using some contingency that we set up in October. You know, if you remember, we had mid-year cuts in October. Where we removed 2% from everybody's budget and put that into a contingency, just in case. This budget is based upon that 2% cut of October. So then this is an additional 2% cut. So again, some departments were able to make the cuts, some were not. One of the ones I remember is Dexter and communications. We were getting to the nitty gritty to make sure Dexter asked me a question. The only cuts I have is personnel, and we would have to cut positions within CCOM. We have to answer those phone calls, so I told Dexter not to make those cuts. So we did try because, again, we were looking at actuals and then 2% cut from October. But the major variables that we've been looking at to try to balance the budget, again, was the 2% departmental cuts. We looked at 6% for outside agencies. Again, as we've talked about before, outside agencies have had increases over the past year. We did talk about in October asking for a 5% revision this year. That was not implemented. So we felt that we were comfortable in looking at 6% for outside agencies. We did recommend in the manager's budget a 2% cost of living. This was straight across the board. The last raises for employees were in 2008.
And we also did recommend in the manager's budget a 2.5% or 2.5 cent tax rate increase. And with that, it gave us a contingency. $636,000. That contingency, part of our thought process on that was to cover any shortfalls from internal departments since we were cutting at 2% less than actuals of last year, but also hopefully not using that contingency, that we would be able to put that back into our fund balance and begin building it back up to where it needs to be.
Can you, for the benefit of the folks seeing this for the first time, go up, back up, Susan, to the four variables, the first screen, the first view that you had? Thank you. Well, yeah, that's good. Any other comments?
By changing those variables, we'll change what we need to come up with. Those are really the major variables that we've looked at as far as this year's budget that is changeable.
Commissioners?
Last time we talked at our work session, you made reference, I think, that 9.2 is the estimated fund balance. That's the percentage it's going to be if everything plays out.
Yes, sir.
Now, is that inclusive of the contingency or not?
No.
It's not. What would the what's the difference between 8% and 9.2 on fund balance?
8% of fund balance would be about $10 million.
Okay.
And then the 9.2 would, I think it's like 11.
11?
11 point. Yeah.
11 what?
About 11.4.
11.4. So with the contingency, you'd be over $12 million, right?
And it, right, that is if we don't use any this year, and we're working real hard to ensure that.
Let me stop you there. Not use any this year? I thought you had estimated for the current year.
We estimated a couple months ago about $2.4 million.
For the year that's ending?
We're still working on that. Hopefully it will not be that much this year. So again, until it all falls out after July 1, we don't have a full handle on it.
Well, but to follow up on Tim's question, let's say that we were able to not use any fund balance this year instead of the $2 million. Is that what you're saying could happen?
Right. That's what he was saying. Mr. Sutton said that we would have about $12 million if we don't use any fund balance
in the current year.
Right.
And we could happen to add that $600,000.
Well, we understand that part, but just let's get a starting point. The current year ending in a month, if we don't use any of the fund balance, what will that percentage be? Is that the 9%?
If we don't use any, it would be about 10.9.
So closer to 11%.
Right.
And Craig, I know there's some end of the year payments and obligations we have, but what's your comfort level as far as using 2 million versus zero? Can we narrow it down a little bit?
I don't know if I have a comfort level yet.
Okay, what would be the amount, Amy, if it was the full $2 million, which I guess is your worst case scenario for the current year?
We would be down to about 9%.
Okay, so the $2 million will obviously.
And I think we'll use some.
Assuming all along, I think 9.2, assuming the two.
The year and the this
right.
year.
Right. Yeah. Because what you did the first of the year, you budgeted 800-some thousand. 800-some thousand. And then you said you didn't think we were going to use but 500, and in less than
through the furloughs,
right, and then in less than three quarters it's up to over two, you know. So that's
and again, a lot of that is the loss of jail revenue.
I understand that, yeah.
Well,
which we should have been able to, no offense, called at budget time last year. I mean, I think the trend was there clearly we weren't going to get $6 million, and I should have caught that. I didn't do it, but. I work here 2 days a month. No offense, y'all were there every day. how much longer are we going to need to, before we know all the bills that are coming in, I mean, and revenue that's coming in? You need 2 months into the fiscal year, a quarter, or what? How long is it before it finally dust settles?
For the month of July and August, we're still accruing figures back to the previous year budget. So you really don't have any final figures until about mid-September. Audited figures.
The whole comment, we don't cut the fire department. I mean, unless we just cut their tax rate, they're going to get their revenue stream, right? So there's not a 2% cut that they can inherit. I'll make sure you understand that, okay? Yeah, no matter what we do tonight, you're going to get your revenue based on your rate for your district, right?
Yes,
sir. Yeah, so there's no cut. You know, you made reference to the 2% that you'd have to close your department. That's not even possible. I'm hardly through. I don't know if somebody else is going to talk.
You say you're hardly
through? I'm going to have a whole lot before we finally do something.
Well, yeah.
No, I'm not ready. I want to see the trend and the flow, and I'll just blend in. I would say this about Ms. Gant's reference to it's only X amount of pennies or dollars or whatever. It's that creep, tax creep, revenue creep, expenditure creep that's happened over the decades. Back when my parents were my age and they were building a house on Rolling Road, they actually leased out the top floor to people who, that's back during the Depression. And their tax rate was about 20 some cents for every dollar that they paid out in taxes. So we've creeped it up now to 40 some cents of every dollar that you pay for some type of taxes or fees. And it's that every year comment of, well, it's only this, it's only $2 more, it's only $5 more, it's only, it's that creep that over a course of decades has taken us from 20-some cents of every dollar to operate government to over 40-some cents of every dollar. So I'm not, I think everybody likes to use that creep. It's only this, it's only that, it's only this. But sure, after a while it adds up. And after a few decades, we're headed towards 50 cents of every dollar to run government.
Let me comment. And obviously, we've all gotten a lot of feedback, very meaningful feedback. I guess one of the things that concerns me is we do brag that our property tax rate is low. It's certainly low compared to a lot of our neighbors. And that certainly is appealing. It's a good thing. The problem is right now our property tax rate is being applied to property values that are artificially high. And if you look at our last revaluation, it occurred in fiscal year 2009, which means the homework was done in 2008 and 2009. So everybody's property was valued right at the peak before the crash. And it was a crash. It wasn't just a recession. Property values here have taken a terrible loss. Jennifer, what, 25, 30, 35% in some cases of true values fallen. So that concerns me that our folks are being taxed on a true value basis higher than certainly the numbers appear. And I don't know that that's going to be fixed until 2017, really. That's the next valuation. I guess one of the things I'd like to ask you to share, and I know you've done a lot of different scenarios within Amy and Susan and Tim Burgess, and I know y'all played around with it, but what would you adjust, or what would you, I guess, most meaningfully adjust of those four variables if this board says to you, okay, make the tax rate increase zero. Now, how you gonna make it work? What comes to your mind? And I know you've thought about a lot of different things. As I said, I'm not putting you on the spot.
Create
and let's see the numbers if that number right there is zero.
If you take that to zero, you would have to remove the cost of living increase. Remove the cost of living. Instead of a 6% cut to outside agencies, it would be a 10% cut. And if you change the contingency. Take it out. I believe we're to get $11,565.
So go back to the four variables now. Yeah, right there. So the department cuts remain the same in that scenario. With this change, what capital allocations are left?
The only capital left is there's $200,000 that is set aside for the Sheriff's Department, and part of that was kind of the trade-off for the Langford security. They were able to use existing jailers and also part-time help that were what was previously budgeted. So instead of having that contract, we would work within the Sheriff's Department and use those savings for vehicles that we have not purchased from county dollars for how many years? Everything that's been purchased been by drug forfeiture. And the original request on that was almost $600,000 that's been cut.
So, Susan, go back to the contingency amount now then. I just want to make sure I'm knowing what you're including or not. Okay, so the contingency is zero, but the allocation for vehicles is still in there somewhere at 200. Okay. All right.
Yeah, but what about the employees?
Employees' raises are not included.
But we did talk about doing bonus days, so I know
there has been discussion with the board about adding if there was no cost of living raises, maybe giving employees bonus days, which are basically additional vacation days that are not added to your vacation bank. So it is time off from work with pay, but if an employee leaves, they don't get paid for any unused hours.
We also, in the current year, still have two furlough days.
Right, there are no furlough days in this proposed budget.
So the combination of both the bonus days and lack of furlough days would be the equivalent of 4 days?
Whatever, the furlough days we had this year were two, so that's about 0.8%, 0.8% of salary that would really be added back to the employees. And also, if you did bonus days, we had 3 bonus days this year, and it could be anywhere, whatever the board so chose on bonus days. You know.
We'd also, Susan, if you go back to those four variables again, we'd also talked about looking at a couple of adjustments in compensation, and we heard suggestions tonight. Mr. Lashley had brought up the idea about employee participation in the 401k. Tell me what you're thinking is there.
We're still moving forward with that proposal. We had to get with our plan and make changes to our plan since it became a match instead of a straight county contribution. We've still budgeted the 2% for 401k because at this point we're unsure of how many employees would take advantage of it.
Well, and we want employees to take advantage
right,
of it.
Right, we want to encourage employees to take advantage of it. But it would be a match up to 2% instead of just a straight 2% allocation.
And Tim had talked about longevity, and that was mentioned a couple of times. I think, do we know what other counties are doing with, I guess, the whole area of indirect benefits? Someone mentioned the medical insurance premiums, longevity pay, the 401k. When's the last time we've actually gone out and looked at other counties' programs or other cities for that matter?
We, between that and also the, I think there's a lot of discussion between what does private industry do as well and having that conversation. We haven't done that, and it's been a while since
we have. Well, longevity we have, because, and yeah. I brought this up yeah. at a work session. Yeah. You know, I assume we forget. Right. The Institute of Government, or School of Government, whatever it is, mm-hmm. in Chapel Hill, they have a report that's online, and it's got a line item for longevity. Right. And if I'm not mistaken, 25% of the counties out of 100 in the state doesn't even offer it. And for instance, Randolph doesn't offer it at all. Davidson, and that can't be more of a comparison to us socioeconomically, median income, population, practically the whole thing. Their longevity pay is only half of what ours is. So yes, I mean, there's all kind of numbers there. And I don't back off. Ours is excessive. I think our package is clearly top of the line. You know, and again, we even did a survey today you know, when I called you, y'all called, I don't even know where it is now, but you called, you had several comparisons of
yes.
of the counties where there's, what, 10 out of how many counties that were reported, only 10, though, that didn't have their employees had to pay.
Right, and well, I guess what I'm saying, we haven't done the comprehensive.
Yeah.
You're exactly right. We did look at it very, very quickly, the numbers on longevity, but to give you a comprehensive spreadsheet between health insurance and dental insurance and vision insurance and copays and non-copays and longevity, 401k, those type issues. We haven't done something.
But the longevity comparison is clearly.
Yes, sir. Longevity is readily available.
Clearly on what?
Well, I think regardless of what happens tonight, what you just described is an exercise that we need to do. If it's been that long.
Yeah, like I said, I haven't done it since I've been here.
I got a question. Allison mentioned that the school budget, their fund balance is $12 million.
Again, if they use what was budgeted this year, what was budgeted next year, yes, it could be $12 million.
Okay, so it could be. It's yes. not right this moment.
Right.
Well, I mean, I can speak my sentiments about education. My time serving on the board, I'm very vested and ingrained in supporting public education. There's no question about that. And I've said before, the combination of public education and support of law enforcement and economic development is what we need to move the county forward. I did pull some numbers out. I learned how to do this from Tim. I pulled out some statistics, and it's a compliment. On civilian labor force in Alamance County going back to 1990. And January 1990, our labor force was 60,600 some people. And by the end of December of 2000, 10 years later, it was 70,100 people. However, from January 2000 to December 2009, that decade, the civilian labor force went from 70,100 to 70,600. We had a very, very stagnant decade. And I think part of what we're seeing and what we're looking at now is a result of the impact of that slowness. And everything's catching up. That's why housing prices are down. That's why we're trying to pull in the money on the expenditures right now. We've only had, it's been modest since the end of 2009 through March of this year. We've gone from 70,600 to 72,800, so roughly 2,200 people. I think the only long-term solution to get out of this mess where we can fund all the agencies what they want and take care of our people the way we want to take care of them is to get people in here to work, increase the property tax base, and get some money in here. And that's what the numbers say. And I think what we have to decide as a board is how to deal with this until that point comes. Like I said, it was easy during the 90s. when you had growth in your labor force of over 1,000 people every year, it was easy to do. We had a lot of growth. We don't have that right now. It doesn't look like we're going to have it in the coming 12 months. Like John said, the next year or two, I think, are going to be just as difficult.
Craig has given us an opportunity there to maybe looking at that without any kind of increase.
Yeah, but he's been awfully selective on what he wants to cut.
Okay.
In my opinion. I mean,
have you got an opinion as to what you'd like to cut, Mr. Sutton?
I'll tell you what, I could balance the budget in a very short time.
Where you been this last 2 months?
And I feel insulted with that comment.
Oh, well, you have to be, because I've been looking at it and trying to figure numbers.
I mean, I know what the facts show about this county. We've got we've got an excellent tax rate for the size of our county. Our bond indebtedness is low. People would kill for what we've got in this county and what we owe for. To insinuate that we've been derelict on this end, I resent that. I resent the hell out of that. To be quite honest about it.
I throw them out there. I'm listening.
I'm not willing to raise taxes. You were wanting to put a sales tax in there and not decrease property taxes a dime. The owners of this county soundly knocked that down in the dirt and covered it up. And I expect they'll do it again. Tonight versus a year ago, what was it, 3 years ago, we sit right here, and we were told revenue neutral was 52, and we voted for it. I didn't. Four commissioners did, and you voted for that, I expect, right? Okay. I didn't vote for it because I didn't think our county manager had gone into the departments and analyzed them as I think any private business manager would, or CEO. That's not me. And so it was approved 4-1, 52, and we lost about eight. We were told that the usual loss of protest, in other words, loss of evaluations after a protest during a reevaluation year, that we might lose $180 million. That was the quote. And then it turned out to be about 900 some million. If I'm not mistaken, I believe it's right, and the estimate there of what the tax rate would, that was like 2.3 cents out. In other words, true revenue neutral that night was about 54, maybe 54.3, and I've said this repeatedly. Everybody's got me down and saying I was willing to raise taxes 2.5 cents. What I said was is, I was willing to consider going to what revenue neutral truly would have been 3 years ago. It may be less. It would be less than revenue neutral, in all honesty. And the public would just not say a word. You know, they said, okay, they said it revenue neutral. They didn't raise taxes. Nobody would have said a word. We all said during the 3 years that if the sheriff's department wasn't bringing in the revenue that they were bringing in, we all acknowledged taxes would be higher. And everybody said, yep, that's right. So, now that's come true. And it's not any fault of our own or the sheriff's. We took the money while we could. And so it's not there anymore. So that my comment, though, to you was I would be willing to consider that if we made substantial cuts. And in my opinion, we haven't made substantial cuts. I think the cuts have been, on the surface. And then our work session, when the longevity scenario came out, I just, I was shocked that it had doubled in the years since we last talked about it. And I had to bring up longevity pay both times. I brought it up the first time, and I'm bringing it up again. And you asked me, where would I cut the budget? If we go to county management off the board, which I think by law we can do, is that not true?
I'm sorry, I don't understand.
In other words, I mean, I know the mayors can do it, the city councils can do it, but you can be the manager of the county off the board. I know the cities can do it. I mean, I'm not trying to debate that point, but.
Counties can do it.
Yeah, I mean, if you ask me where to cut, I could do it. I mean, and you could do it. It's just that we all have a different opinion of where to do it. Like, you know, cutting schools to 10% versus the 6, I would object to that. Because I think they're paid their, they're being hit hard enough. It's my personal opinion. Okay, but you know, we're not hitting other areas that we could hit. You could go in and hit longevity pay, you could go, hey, when's the last time that we've gone into a department and sat back and analyzed whether they needed the people that you saw and what they were doing? I mean, when's the last time we've ever done that and somebody's been let go as a result of it?
We do have a automatic 90-day freeze. And again, under performance-based budgeting, it's going to change some things. The 90-day freeze is not going to be there as of July 1, but that was part of that 90-day freeze, was to go back and analyze and see if we had to fill the position or not.
Yeah. So I just don't think we run it like a business, you know, and I'm not against any county government employee. I swear I'm not. I mean, but I've always been in the private sector, and you get told you're not going to get your bonus this year because we're not having a good time. Everybody says, oh, okay. Yeah, I hate that. Or, you know, if you get, you know, given more job duties to do, I mean, yeah, man, I hate that, but okay. And it's the can-do attitude of getting it done. But everybody's idea of how to balance this budget without tax, I guarantee you, yours would be different from mine. But you, if it was in my lap, I could take care of it. If it's in your lap, I hope you would. And I think what we got to do tonight is tell Craig Honeycutt that it is his baby to do with whatever rate we give him, and then go do it. I personally think that 52 cents on the tax rate, based on what I have seen, and the sales tax revenue that I think will be there, is enough to run this county efficiently. It might not be what everybody wants, it might not be the salaries they want, it might not be the benefits that they want, but it can be done, and I would say, go do it. Now, I think there should be I'd like to see us maybe have you show us what you want to cut to do it, because I would disagree with you on the 10% theory, because I believe you can do it without that. I'm not, it's like one of the speakers said tonight, I'm not necessarily opposed to going to the 8% level of the fund balance. Not tremendously opposed to that, because I don't think our bond ratings would change a whole lot. I don't think the state's going to say a whole lot. There's been some misinformation about what the state would do if we went below the 8. And they would not come over and come into our county and take over, and they would not raise our taxes. The only time they told me they would come into this county would be if we couldn't pay our bond indebtedness. That's what they told me. But, yeah, I could balance this budget. Okay. But I'm only one commissioner, and it takes 3 votes and a county manager that will do what we tell them to do. And I support Mr. Mosier's comments about Craig. Craig is, I like Craig. I was, you know, one of his biggest supporters when we hired him. But he's only done what this board has told him to do. And maybe we've been too nice about it. Maybe, you know, I don't like the attitude of, well, it's whatever the commissioners want to do. And I mean that with all due respect. You're the manager. I hope we can tell you what the tax rate will be, and then go do it. And that's just how I feel about it. But yeah, I could balance this budget. But it wasn't that for me to do it all by myself every year I've been on the board. I'm proud of my track record.
I support everything Tim said. If you want to make that a motion, Tim, I'll second.
Well, we can talk further about what people want to do. I'm not trying to ramrod this. I didn't like that comment.
Well, we need to give Craig some direction at this point.
I think what Tim said is the direction. Tell him I'm not going to support anything over 52 cents on the 100, the same thing it is now.
That's what I was saying.
And tell Craig to make the cuts, and if it's people, that's what we do. Let him give him the job that he's hired to do.
Any of that, but we got to come up with a, do we delay it? Is that what we do, Tim? I mean, should we delay it?
Well, I don't know that that's necessary. I still think we've got the four variables that are determining where we're going to be right there. Now, yeah, there's certainly line items within that, and I don't wish to get in and, you know, manage the individual lines, but looking at everything we've been looking at since we first started talking about it in February, it really comes down to allocation within the county departments, the outside agencies, a raise or not a raise for the employees, and that's going to result in our tax rate.
Well, we could set the tax rate tonight and then talk later about what we're cutting and what we're not cutting. I mean, we're not in stone on that as a result of. Just like you're able to take in the middle of the fiscal year, you can say, well, we're going to cut you 4%. We're going to cut you 2%. That's what we did this year. So the theory would hold true.
Okay, I'll make a motion that we keep the tax rate at 52 cents on the 100.
Second.
A motion and a second. I will call for other discussion. And my main question to Craig is that enough of a framework for you to go from here with what you had and what you have? I don't want to put you in a position, and I don't think this board does, where...
if that is the direction of the board, we will make it work. I will be, again, the reason why I recommended a tax increase, and again, it is not ever an easy thing for a manager to do, especially in a very conservative community that Alamance County is. I have a concern about, as we talked about, our bond ratings fell because of a lack of fund balance. I have a concern about cutting us to a point where sometimes in some departments it's not to the bone, it may be to the marrow. And there are cuts available. I'm not saying that there's not cuts, and please don't listen to that. That is my concern, is that I'm worried a little bit for the future on sustainability on this. I don't know if growth will take care of our future revenue needs, but if this is the direction the board would like to go in, we will find a way to make it work. But I just wanted to state my professional concerns. But I work for you, and I support what you direct me to do, and I will make it work.
Additional discussion?
That means no tax increase.
That's all we're saying.
No tax increase.
That's the only parameter that we're fixing.
That's all we're fixing, and we'll
work. That suits me fine.
I guess.
Speak out. This is...
Got a motion and a second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Pass unanimous. What do we have left? Well, next item on the agenda is the county manager's report.
Hell. I have nothing to this So I got a lot of work to do.
Sorry for lack of direction.
I have direction.
Well, let's before we leave the county manager's report section, develop an understanding. Are you going to be in a position to kind of bring us that plan at our next meeting, which is 2 weeks from tonight? Put in place, and based on what you heard tonight and what you heard from Tim the effects of the no furloughs and additional bonus days and how that can be incorporated, all you're okay with all that?
And are you saying on the outside agencies, no
10%?
Is that what you're saying?
I'm not necessarily saying don't want to see. I want to see all the options. I don't want anything not saying, well, I'm not going to cut that because we don't want to cut that.
You know, we don't want to cut this. I want to see everything that we can cut, and then go, and then we can go from there. Yeah, and I don't think that has to even be done at the next meeting, as far as I wouldn't think legally.
Well, you have to have something in place by the end of June.
Well, we, the tax rate, the budget ordinance, you know, filling in the blanks on the budget ordinance is where we're at now.
Right, okay. All right, clarification. Have we then, by virtue of approving this tax rate, have we addressed the fire departments?
We have not addressed the fire department. You know, you can make a motion to approve, if you so chose, all of them except Fawcett, and do Fawcett at the next meeting.
I thought we couldn't do that.
Well,
Fine says we can't.
Yeah. There's only one, right?
Yeah.
Right.
Well, yeah, okay, so if we don't discuss Holt, Holt doesn't change from what it was last year.
Right, Holt, it's just
okay,
Elon.
So, yes,
okay.
Is there a motion that we approve the Elon request?
So moved.
Okay, and let's, for the record, state that the tax rate is going to go an increase of 0.5 cent, I believe, from what to what?
Yes.
Elon was
8.75 to 9.25.
10.5 to 11.
10.5 to 11.
Getting confused.
Okay.
10.5.
All right. Is there a motion, or did we? Did I already? Bill gave that motion.
We need to hope it's going to stay the same.
Well, yeah, that's not a change.
Okay.
All right. All in favor of that? Say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Aye. And we'll address Fawcett later. And do you have any other?
And I guess it needs to be a motion passed for the additional fire departments as well, that as presented.
Which represent no change from last year. Is there such a motion?
So moved.
Bill?
Second.
Linda? Any discussion on the other fire departments? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any other reports? Mr. Honeycutt?
No.
Commissioner comments. I should say commissioner closing comments. Any others?
Thank goodness we didn't raise taxes.
Do we have any announcements?
We'll make it, folks.
Well, again, thank you to each of you who showed the interest and took the time to be with us tonight. We really do appreciate that. With that, we'll stand adjourned.